Hello, welcome to this lecture on community action. My name is Jacqueline Broersen and I'm Professor of Innovation and Communication in the Health and Life Sciences, and I specifically focus on the topic of global health and especially stakeholder involvement in intervention design and implementation. So today the topic is community action, and specifically looking at it in the context of health promotion. So that's the topic. And I will first explain what is community action, then go into why such a community approach. I will give an example. And then after the break, I will go into the more details about the different concepts. I will give you more guidelines on how to implement it, as well as pitfalls, because it's not an easy thing to do on the ground. So there are quite a number of constraints and barriers to take into account. Okay, but first, what is community action? Well, community action, it's important to realize that it's set apart from health education in health promotion. Health education is more an individually oriented activity. You're trying to convey a message, raising people's awareness, increasing their knowledge, and then hopefully they will change behavior. That's basically the idea of health promotion. Now, community action takes a much broader perspective. It is not focused on the individual, but rather on the community as a whole. So, as a network, a collective of individuals. And it's particularly set in that community context. So, and the community context can be, well, often it is a geographical area, a neighborhood. But it can also even be a school setting, for example, so it can be within an institution. But at the same time, it can be virtual, like nowadays with social media, we have a community on social media where people more virtually meet. So, but all of them are in a community because they share a certain background, a certain interest, and they feel somehow connected to each other. Beware, it's a very subjective perspective, so people consider themselves to be part of that group. So it's not easy as a researcher to draw a line, okay, this is a community. And it's very important. And with community action, then you work with the people in that community, where they are, where they live, work, and play. Yeah? So it's what is said here, everyday life. That's the central of community action. And important, apart from the community, we have the action part. It is about actual change, not something that is going to happen afterwards, like with health education. You provide the information and hope that people will change later based on that. Here, the change process takes place in the activity itself. So it's therefore community action. In addition, it means that actually people in that community have to work together in that community to achieve that certain goal. And that means that you work with this community, with the individuals in this community together to achieve that. And that requires a participatory approach. So it's basically about participation. So not as a researcher more top-down working with them, but actually you are on the same level engaging with the people in the community. It's also not singular. Like with health education, you often see that it is it's a module, or it is a campaign, a poster campaign, or other sort of multimedia. But here, it's not just one intervention. It's actually a multiple interventions that can also be, and that's another one, at different levels. Because basically you don't only view the problem, the health problem, that people have in that context on that specific community, perhaps let's call it a neighborhood level, but you also go beyond it because people don't function in isolation. They have contacts outside the community, they interact with institutions, they are being influenced by policies. So within community action, you take these multiple levels into account when developing your interventions. And last but not least, that is that has as an automatic implication that as a scientist, you often work with different disciplines. Because one of the important consequences of such an approach is that you don't come in with a predetermined idea of what people, what the problem is that people have. Rather, you need to find out what they want to work on. And that means that actually it could be also involving the educational sector. It could involve the welfare sector, apart from health. So in that case, you will also work with different sectors. So you often work with different disciplines and different sectors. So it's not only collaborative with the people, but also the professionals have to collaborate together. Now, why? Because it actually sounds, to some extent, complicated. Huh? It's not anymore like you're consulting people by a questionnaire or doing interviews or focus groups, trying to get information. Then you go to your desk, you draft your intervention, and then you hand it over to the, well, probably you'll pilot it first, and then hand it over to the ones that are supposed to work with it. That is a more linear, easy approach. However, with community action, with all the collaboration and the multi-level thing, it's quite a different endeavor. So you don't do that for nothing. You do it because previously it didn't work so well. Now, why are we increasingly turning to community action as an approach? Basically because raising awareness and translating knowledge into behavioral change is actually not so easy. With normal health education, you are able to raise the awareness and to some extent increase knowledge, but this last step, the translation into actual behavior, is extremely complicated. So we might need a new approach. Another reason is that we see that many of the health messages, the health interventions, reach those in society that are more highly educated and are in a better socioeconomic position. So basically, many of the health interventions reach a certain target group more than another, and that those most in need, actually the disadvantaged groups in the disadvantaged areas, are left out. So looking at intervention studies and their evaluations, you see actually that many interventions increase the gap, the health gap, between higher educated and lower educated people. And that actually cannot be something that you, from the start, aimed for. So, if you really want to include those, it's also important. And another one is that, actually, if you do this well, and through this process of participation, actually you do more than just solving problems. You are actually changing people's position within society by empowering them, by giving them a real say, a real voice in the decision-making process, that, and through these collaborations as well, the networks that you are developing, you create social capital. And that's important, very important. You increase people's resource base, yes, especially for disadvantaged groups. So in this setting, with very complex, with a complex problem, or at least a complex pathway, disadvantaged areas and groups, and the need for the possibility of increasing social capital, community action is growing in importance as approaches over the past 10 years. Now, I already said something about a linear approach, huh? Because we have been doing this already for a long time, trying to solve complex problems in health. So most researchers in health sciences, in global health, they do this because you, as a way to contribute to improved health for all. And so researchers' intent has always been for the good, for the better. However, if we look at the track record of intervention studies, we see that, of course, we do evidence-based interventions. We want proof of principle and we want them to be cost-effective. So many intervention studies are set up as an RCT, a randomized controlled trial, to make sure that all confounders are left out as much as possible and we can draw causal relations so we really can understand the effect of an intervention. So this sounds really good from a scientific perspective. However, from a societal perspective, there are drawbacks. It is by a positive pilot, it's actually by no means a guarantee for smooth implementation. And we, in many evaluation studies, have actually observed what we call an implementation gap. And so we wanted to find out this implementation gap. What is this about? Why is there such an implementation gap? Now, what these studies have shown is that actually we have so far treated research often in research and innovation, in the intervention design, often in a linear fashion. We have here the problem, a specific health problem. We define it, we conduct research, we do an we pilot an intervention, we get the results, and then we hand it over as researchers to societal partners who are supposed to implement it. So actually, we're talking pretty much about a compartmentalized process where we have society here. Here we have the universities, or research institutes for that matter, and then it's handed over back to society. Now you can already imagine that that's actually become silos. So you have here, you actually have also not only an implementation gap at the end, but we also have a demand gap. So if you have two gaps, because researchers interpret the problem, so they often predefine for this group what is the most important problem, translate it into a researchable research question, and then later on hand it over. So we have two gaps. Now, how to deal with those gaps? Well, somehow we need to bridge better, huh? Well, if you have two silos, society and science research, the most logical thing, I think you will agree with me, is that we need to improve communication, because obviously we don't communicate well enough about these, over these boundaries. So you need somehow to span the boundary. Well, one of the ways to do it is to better communicate. Yeah, you can hear, science could listen better to society about what's really going on here. At the other hand, they can explain better, so people can better work with the interventions, the results of science. So far, so good. Unfortunately, it doesn't work like that, because even when you try to communicate better, it is found that there is too much interpretation. And people only tell you so much, huh? Because they only tell you what they think, that they explicate their knowledge in a certain way. It turns out that you can only really truly understand one another if you collaborate. So even if you just focus on communication, there are still gaps. So that means that if we want to really design solutions, interventions for complex problems, we have to work together. Science and practice need to join hands. Yeah. That actually means that we enter into a new type of research. Because of course we are still scientists and want to do it in a good way, yeah? In a scientific way, in a structured way. And that means we enter the field of transdisciplinary research. Yeah? Transdisciplinary research is defined as a new form of learning and problem solving involving cooperation among different parts of society and academia. So here's the multidisciplinary work, as well as the link between science and society, to meet complex challenges of that society. So it's really about problem solving. And we can contrast it in a different way to the often used terms in science: monodisciplinarity, multidisciplinarity, interdisciplinarity, and transdisciplinarity. Now, most scientists are trained in mono/multidisciplinary ways of working. Discipline means there is an understanding what is a good research question. So what is required? What is the sort of knowledge that we want to obtain? There's an idea on how to obtain that knowledge. So there is a set methodology together with clear ideas about concepts that are relevant. So that is a certain way of understanding reality and researching reality. And it turns out that different disciplines do this in a different way. Now, this biology does it totally different from physics, and that does it different from anthropology, which is quite different from law. Yeah, so that actually means for a complex problem, and a problem is really complex and has many different perspectives and aspects, you need these different disciplines. But disciplines don't easily work together. We are again in that communication problem. Here they actually they work side by side. So if you're studying a complex problem, what you would do, that one would look at the, let's say, the biological side, and another would look at the more educational and more political, etc. And then each would answer their own questions in their own way, and at the end we will staple it together and that's it. Yeah? You can imagine that for complex problems this is not the best way to achieve it. So therefore, actually, we have created interdisciplinarity, where the boundaries between the disciplines are actually blurred by working together and jointly defining the problem and jointly determining the concepts and the methodologies. Now, here it's not only about academia, it's also about different parts of society that collaborate. So for very complex problems, we say it's not only the knowledge from the scientific disciplines which is relevant, it's also the knowledge in society, about the perspectives on the problem, the ideas, what will work and what won't work, and what are priorities. That needs to be part of the research process. So that means that the non-academic environment, and particularly the people in there, are part of the research process. And that's what we call transdisciplinarity. So community action approach, therefore, entails a transdisciplinary research approach. Now let's turn to an example, because what does it mean on the ground? It all sounds perhaps a bit abstract, complicated even. Now, how could we translate that on the ground in a specific project? Here I take a case that a research project that I did together with a PhD student. So here you already see that since this was the basis of a PhD thesis, that actually the research was highly scientific. All the different research parts were published in international peer-reviewed journals, and the person indeed obtained his PhD. So we can say this is really scientific in that respect. Now, we were looking at HIV/AIDS, and HIV/AIDS is typically a complex problem. It has many different causes at different levels. It's not just the virus. It has to do with gender, with behavior, with knowledge, but also with livelihoods. So the resources that people have, the community institutions that are there, the violence that may be there, but also even more at the macro level, it has to do with culture, with policies, with poverty, wealth, infrastructures. So definitely it's a multi-level problem. It's not just the HIV infection. That also means that the consequences can be seen at many different levels. And that, on the other hand, responses need to be also at multiple levels. So we have a complex problem that is not so easy to change. And here the idea was, how can we actually mitigate the impact of HIV/AIDS? Not in a medical sense, so by primarily looking for antiretroviral treatment, so diagnosis and treatment. No, it was here very much about a broad health promotion approach. So that was the idea. We did the work in South Africa, in Msinga, it's in KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa, which is a predominantly rural area, quite traditional. Like in many other areas in South Africa, poverty and unemployment rates are quite high. Food insecurity is a serious problem there. And if you ask people around there what is their main problem, in many cases they would call the lack of food as a very, very important problem. Many of the households are female-headed, basically because many of the men have moved to the cities for jobs because of the poverty and unemployment. So they leave their families behind and the women take care of the farming, because most of them in this rural area are involved in small-scale farming activities. HIV prevalence in the area is very high. Among the adult population, 1 out of 4, 5 are infected by HIV. There is a home-based care system where there's good access to antiretroviral therapy. But at the same time, HIV/AIDS-related stigma is incredibly high. So it is a taboo subject. It's definitely not something you talk about. All in all, we can clearly say we are talking here, if we go back to the theory about community action, right, that we are talking here about a disadvantaged area and disadvantaged groups. So the community action approach comes to mind. We have the complexity. You need to look at it from different perspectives, various disciplines that each shed different light on the problem. So we have different problem framings, etc., as well as a disadvantaged area. So the most logical conclusion that we drew in any way is that we needed a transdisciplinary community action approach. Involving a variety of stakeholders. So we identified as stakeholders patients as such, but in this case, I wouldn't not in beforehand call them patients, because in most cases we wouldn't know whether they are HIV positive or not. So it's actually more community members than patients as such, but also health professionals, policymakers, people in the field of agriculture, education, etc., etc., are relevant. So we drafted a project, a 2-year community action project. It was financed by one of the UN research programs, and it involved, besides us as a university, 2 organizations, an agricultural NGO and a health NGO. So already knowing in a rural area, it would involve both agriculture, given the food insecurity, as well as health, given the high prevalence of HIV/AIDS. So that was the setting of the project. Now, how did we go about it? Because it also tells you quite a bit about how to structure it. Huh? So community action has different phases. It's complex, so you don't just quickly go in, define the problem, conduct some research and then go on and develop your intervention and test it. This requires much more preparation. Then it needs a very in-depth understanding of the problem context. It really requires, given the community approach, it really requires an exchange and integration among community members, as well as different stakeholders, as well as different disciplines and sectors. It requires a prioritization and planning phase, and it's to be done jointly before going into experimental cycles. Because the interesting thing is that we, in these types of projects, rarely take an RCT approach. So where you have a very strict design, implementation over a certain period of time, and that's it. Here, what you do is that you actually have cycles of implementation and adaptation. So it's not a one-off thing. And therefore, we always say it's an action research cycle. You conduct the action, you evaluate, monitor, and you adapt, and then you go into action again. And that's a recurrent cycle. Now, let's go into a bit more detail about what it is. So what did we do in the first phase, in the initiation and preparation? Here, it's about not only a research team, it's about a project team. And a project team typically does not only involve researchers, but also others. And in this case, it were staff members of the NGOs that were involved, the health NGOs and the agricultural NGOs. So you actually start a partnership. But also, you cannot just go in and work in an area. It is something that you need to organize. Are you welcome? To what extent do people feel it's in their interest? So it requires quite a bit of talking at the municipalities and with traditional leaders, whether this is, they feel this is a good idea. Because it was, to some extent, an outside initiative. Huh? So community action can also be an inside initiative. In that case, community members define that their need and then they go and look for researchers to help them. In this case, it was us having an idea that we had the aim to mitigate HIV/AIDS in such a disadvantaged area. But you need to link up. If there is no win-win scene, then it won't fly. So the first thing we needed to do was this. Is there a win-win? Or have we thought up something that nobody there locally is really interested in? We needed, of course, to organize funding. Yeah, and we needed ethical approval. Because if you're working with such vulnerable groups, this is something that, well, it requires definitely adherence to a code of conduct. Yeah, informed consent, a contract, how to work with one another. In such a phase, you also really need to start understanding the context, the different stakeholders, but also, it's a community approach, you need to understand the networks, so the interactions between people. And who would like to participate? Because it's nice if the authorities say in the municipality, great idea. You also need to know whether people who define themselves as a community feel this is in their interest. So by the end, we had a project team, we had approval from the local authorities, we had funding, we had ethical approval, we knew more about the context of Masinga. We had selected three areas where there were three support groups. And the support groups, those were our communities. But don't forget that these communities are communities of poor women, women who consider themselves poor. Interesting, it were not people who defined themselves with the topic HIV/AIDS. Huh? And that's a logical thing given the fact that HIV/AIDS-related stigma is so high. So if you come in and say, oh, we're going to do an HIV/AIDS project, nobody wants to join in because nobody wants to have to do anything with it. And given the fact that it was us to do about poverty and health in general, food security, health in general, we defined it as a poverty project, basically. And given the fact that the prevalence was 20-25%, we knew that in this batch there would be a large number of people HIV positive. And a lot of people who would be affected by HIV, either by caring for foster children whose parents died of HIV/AIDS. We had quite a few grandmothers in the group caring for orphans. So this was for us very important as a starting point. Yeah. And the group size differed between the 30 and the 60. Next, the in-depth phase. And we particularly took a livelihoods model approach. So the livelihoods model, sustainable livelihood, was how we wanted to understand the context of these women. We wanted to understand not only the individual, but also at the household level, what their resources were, what kind of stress factors were affecting them, how they dealt with it, so how they what kind of structures and processes they could use to mitigate, to strategize for these shocks and stresses, and eventually how this strategizing, what was the impact of that on their livelihood. And livelihood assets had to do with finance, situation, physical, social, etc. So this was the framework by which we analyzed their situation. And in the in-depth study phase, well, first of all, and I this is not on the slide, we did quite a number of interviews, something like 30 interviews, with all sorts of stakeholders in that area. So village leaders, school teachers, health workers in that area, but also agricultural extension workers, etc. So we did a broad stakeholder analysis, but with the women and the broader communities, we conducted focus groups to understand their livelihood, farming, health, in the broad sense. We had a questionnaire among 129 households, that goes beyond our support groups, to understand more broader the household structures, livelihood, health, and HIV/AIDS, and all sorts of perceptions on their life in general. And then we did a number of really what we call more case study-like interviews that were much more implied to delve into, in this case, the impact of HIV/AIDS. And that was only with 10 people because, well, we couldn't get more people to want to talk about HIV/AIDS. And we really wanted to see how they deal with it. So what? How does it affect their life? Now, this resulted in a picture of what it is to live in that area and in that context. And we found actually a lot of, the energy was low, let's say. Now, people were afraid, and not only, they were afraid of the violence in the area, especially the women. They didn't dare to go out at night. When the dark would fall in, they would want to leave their houses. They were afraid of HIV/AIDS. At the same time, they didn't want to think about it, so there was a lot of denial. But overall, people were very pessimistic about the future. And they felt like, okay, we are stuck. Nothing can be done. This is it. When delving into HIV/AIDS, the knowledge, the interesting thing is that people knew a lot about HIV/AIDS. So, and when you asked about it, there were lots of campaigns on the radio. Of course, people don't, hardly any had any person had television there. It was mainly by radio that they heard. So they could tell about the virus and the way it was transmitted. But the interesting thing was they knew much more, in the sense that they also knew that you could get it when sharing cutlery or sitting in the bus together. And there were all sorts of ideas on how you could could treat HIV/AIDS by going to traditional healers or sleeping with a virgin. Yeah, so that also meant that there were lots of misconceptions and myths there. It was clear that it affects all aspects of livelihood. It is very profound in people's lives. And when we were in the area, there was really a funeral every Saturday. There were funerals, and most of them were had to do with AIDS deaths. But it's given the complex, it's given the overall lack of resources and lack of access to services, you see that in such a constrained situation, it's not easy to say that this is due to HIV/AIDS. And this is the... So it's a complex reality that people can hardly... If you ask them to conceptualize their problem, they initially find it extremely difficult to disentangle it. So it really takes at an individual level, they get stuck. Basically, because of this hopelessness, they don't know where to start. Yeah, and if they deal with it, it's not so much strategizing, basically because people don't analyze. So they don't really plan, it's just coping. It's just living from one day to another. But one thing is clear, HIV/AIDS makes things a lot worse. So people get into a downward spiral of impoverishment, in which food insecurity plays a major role as well. Okay, now what to do? Where to start in such a situation? Well, the importance of restoring a household's resource base is incredibly important. Remember community action, which is one of the tools to build social capital? This is actually what is needed. Yeah? So you need to start building people's resource base, while at the same time addressing this hopelessness, so the psychosocial issues that people are faced with. This works very well in groups as well. If you talk about those issues, people find consolence in recognition, to recognize the same things in others. So they find comfort there, which gives room to discuss these kinds of things. And it could find, and it was also important to somehow try to reduce the stigma. Now, that's not an easy thing, huh? But we found that if women work together, if they go out into the field, not in a setting, in a classroom setting or in a focus group setting, but when people really work and do things together, it suddenly does become possible to talk about HIV/AIDS. So it reduces stigma. So the action aspect is very important to deal with stigma. Yeah. So, and given the enormous problem of food insecurity, we found, together with the women, that farming would be also, apart from the collectiveness, would be a good action to work on, given that that would produce food. And if it would produce surplus food, they could even get some cash, for which they could build not only their social capital resource base, but also really their financial resource base and their physical resource base. So, farming would be a very good entry point. Working in that way on social inequalities, because we were working with the poorest women in those areas, and we realized that we should try to help them increase their access to services, because they often didn't know their way. So we were talking about HIV/AIDS, working through agriculture, and linking them to social and health services as well. So you see here how this is a multi-sectoral activity as well, requiring various disciplinary knowledge. Now, how to go about it? So if you do this, how can you then further plan in such a way that it's not you doing the planning? Well, we, together with the women, selected the Pharma Life School. That is a way of working together in weekly sessions, which is partly an educational approach. So that's why the school is there. The educational approach means that actually the women determine their own program, what they want to learn. And experts are asked to come in and provide information. But for us, it was important that these classroom sessions were not in the classical sense, but very interactive. So these women, we would very much encourage them to ask questions and also to have workshop-like activities. So not just one-way education. It would also include experimentation, ideas about what sort of experiments could you do. And then it would result in this, these action learning spirals. And so, the intervention types of things. But it would be through these first and then setting up the experiments themselves. Now, what this resulted in was a curriculum for 6 weeks, so six sessions, where the curriculum comprised of an introduction, setting the stage in general, vision and organization, actually building the support groups, because only one of the support groups was already pre-existing. The other two were established in the project. So they wanted to know more about leadership, how to organize their group. They wanted to know more about sustainable farming. They wanted to know about nutrition, about social and health issues. And then they wanted to set up design experiments. And I said here, lunch there. And it actually should be end lunch, because one of the important things was that we provided lunch during these sessions. And that was highly appreciated because of the food insecurity. This was appreciated. And when there was food left, they took it home with them for their families. So this was implemented in the three support groups. And of course, that was part of our research work, closely monitored and evaluated how the women, how the different support groups experienced the program. So what came out? What did they learn? So we had follow-up interviews, apart from the fact that we also did a lot of participant observation. And afterwards, we also had focus groups with the women to jointly reflect on this based on a kind of feedback of our analysis. So we wanted to, based on the participant observation and the interviews, we wanted to validate our findings and discuss them and find ways on how to improve for another cycle. The interesting was afterwards, so we had actually one of the all three groups came up with a, it was an interesting finding, as a matter of fact, that they came up with similar interventions. Not precisely, but all of them wanted to do more with home gardening, but not home at home. They wanted to have vegetable gardens, but also small plots of maize in a communal area. And the nice thing was that they could experiment there very well with different sorts of crops and cultivation practices. But they could also work together there. So it was a collective activity where they would team up, and if people fell ill, the others could take over. So it was really also a way of them for collectively move forward. And after that, after a first round, it was continued. We had consecutive rounds of of Pharma Life School, as well as experimentation, and the Health and Agriculture NGO continued the project after the 2 years. So, and it was also expanded after the 2 years. So it was introduced in more villages with more support groups. Now we go into the break, because this is what I would like to share with you now. But after the break, I will go more into the different concepts in more in detail, more about guidelines of implementation, but also because it sounds now like a success story, and it partly was a very much of a success story, but we also encountered a lot of barriers. And it didn't all go well immediately. Like one of the support groups had real trouble performing well. And it was especially the pre-existing group that was very quickly able to pick up and already after the first season, first growing season, make a profit and put this in a bank account and etc. So they didn't all perform in the same way and in the same pace. But and that I would like to go into after the break. Okay, see you later.